Yes, it was the 1970s, the apex of human civilization, where the rock and roll scene was all about tight pants and high hair. And of course, with their hit song Jump in My Car, the Ted Mulry gang shot out of nowhere to be the biggest band in the country. And joining us now to tell their story are Herm Kovac on the drums and Gary Dixon on the guitar from the Ted Mulry gang. And, of course, we have, just when you thought this couldn't get any bigger, we have flown in another big celebrity direct from Warm Adelaide, where he's at the World Music Festival. Yeah. He has come here. He didn't even have time to put on any pants. It's Jono Coleman.
Yeah, peace, man. Peace. I'm alive.
I was about to say, do not let that camera pan down, but it's too late for that.
It's good to be alive, isn't it?
Adelaide made me swell up a bit.
Thank you very much for joining us, Herman Gary. Now, tell us a bit about where you guys came from, because you started from oblivion.
Well, not really, because Ted had a solo career well before us.
Forget about him. No. What's he ever done? Ted, no, you have a solo career, you're right.
He had a couple of really big hits prior to the band. And he tried to go out live and play live, and he realised that he better get a band together.
A good-looking band, too.
Yeah, of course.
Well, a good-looking drummer. Yes. Yeah.
You know. And how was it? Who was it that got... Because someone got in his ear, didn't they? And they said, mate, I think you might need to... I think you might need a few guys behind you.
Yeah, and so that's how the evolution of the band came. And
He had pickup bands, right? Yep. And Les and I were in a band with Malcolm Young called Velvet Underground.
Yep.
And the agency put us on the same bill all the time. And it was in Canberra at Albert Hall. I saw Ted with a pickup band. I kid you not, every song, every member changed instruments, right? Yep. And Ted's just... Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. What do you
mean? Then I said to Ted afterwards, look, if we're ever on the same bill again, we'll back you. And then we all loved the Beatles, got on really well, and then it just morphed into the Ted Mulry gang.
But also, you guys have played some pretty iconic gigs. I mean, I remember I was at a thing shooting for Simon Townsend's Wonderworld, and it was the 2SM Concert of the Decade in Sydney on the Sydney Opera House steps.
Oh, yeah.
Dragon, Thin Lizzy,
JPY,
Ted Mulry, and people were literally... jumping, you know, when you played on that floating platform, I saw girls jumping off the sort of swimming over to you. Look at that.
Well, see the girl that they fish out of that clip? We played in Brisbane in November.
And she was still
wet. And this middle-aged woman came up to us and said, I'm the girl that dived into the water.
Yeah. And where is she now?
Well, she didn't dive. I think our road crew were throwing the girls back in the water.
That's enough of that. But it was an amazing band. I mean, look, the thing is that you guys played your instruments, and as Joe was saying, I've just come back from Adelaide, and it was the same sort of vibe in those days. People were chilled out. They loved it. There was not sort of big, beefy security guards. People weren't worried about security as much, but you still had a fantastic time.
There we go.
Yeah, that's her. Dinah. That's her name.
Dinah.
I see you got to meet her. So, going back now to 1975, where you've just released Jump in My Car, and then that summer in 1976, the biggest band in the world, I think ABBA, were bigger in Australia than they were just about anywhere else in the world. It cannot be overstated how huge they were here. They were like the Beatles here.
Mm.
And then, bang, Jump in My Car knocks them off the number one spot. Suddenly, you guys are the biggest
first
band
place in the
Australia.
World. Happened to.
What does that
Mia,
feel
yeah,
like?
Yeah, knocked it off, and it was great because it wasn't an American band or an English band. It was just a little Australian band with their first single that knocked it off.
But you looked like an international band. That was the amazing thing because, you know, people to me in the UK always said to me, oh, that Ted Mulry and Jump in My Car, was that a hit before that other bloke had it with the Knight Rider and the sort
David
of
Hasselhoff?
David Hasselhoff. Did you ever meet David Hasselhoff? Did he thank you?
No, but Gary hasn't been the same since because he really wanted to meet him, you know.
No, I've never
actually, the best cover version of that song was by Chris Bedding. He did a great version.
He was the guitarist of Roxy Music.
Yeah, yeah.
And he did a version, and it was a mild hit in England.
But forget about the covers. What was it like when you guys were number one in the country and suddenly you've gone from, you know, this is stratospheric success that none of you had ever had before. What changed then? Was it... Did you have a whole bunch of, you know, groupies? Did you have a whole bunch of accountants?
Well, I'll tell you what. You know, we played at the Horton Pavilion, right? This is hard to imagine. We'd have to go to Roger Davies, our management, at Bondi. And, you know, the armoured vans that take money to the bank?
Yeah.
We'd have to climb into one of those, go to the Horton, back up to the door, and you could not see daylight.
Mm.
And in Adelaide once, we went to a store promotion in a hire car, And after they cancelled the store promotion, there were too many fans there. You could not see daylight. The roof started caving in. And we just floored it, and about three or four girls wound up in hospital.
Well, you came close to breaking the Beatles record in Adelaide. They've still got a picture of the Beatles cut out in the Adelaide post office, or the town hall, Adelaide town hall, where you guys were there and the Beatles were there. And now that they're re-releasing Ted Mulry Gang on vinyl.
You've been paying him, have you?
No, no. Do yourself a favour. Next week on Countdown, this is going to be number one, I guarantee it.
But I do remember before Jump Macau actually got on the charts, I remember playing at a gig at Newtown Lee's Club, and there would have been about 10 people there.
Wow.
And I remember the agent walking in and coming up to me and saying, "Congratulations, Gary." And I said, "What did I do?" And he said, "Well, yeah, Jump Macau's on the top 40 on 2SM.
Oh, well, right. We're going to get 20 people next week. Yes.
Right. But the following week.
So you went from playing for 10 people at Newtown RE.
And the following week, he said, "You're on an open air concert at Broadway with Sherbet,
ACDC,
And we walked out at that concert to 20,000 people.
Victoria Park.
Yeah, being transported in an armoured car.
I saw you guys playing at Victoria Park. That was another radio station.
Yeah, on the
concert.
Rooftop.
Yeah. Were ABBA fans upset that you kicked their favourite band off?
We actually got to meet ABBA because of it. Because we knocked Mamma Mia off number one.
Thanks for doing that, by the way.
Second single, Darktown Strutter's Ball, could not get past Fernando. And we're in Melbourne, and their record company, they were over at the service desk, and we were having tea, and brought them over and said, "Look, we were just telling Benny and Bjorn that you guys knocked Mamma Mia off number one, but you cannot get past Fernando." And they're going, "Oh, we're so sorry." And they were apologising.
But you're still going. That's the main thing.
It was
right,
just something in the air that night. how was it? We've seen a lot of bands lose their lead singers. Lead singers often live fast and die young. How did you go when you lost Ted in 2001?
Because Michael Hutchins went. Of course, Bon Scott went from ACDC.
We didn't play for about 16 years.
Wasn't there? Because a lot of the lead singers died.
Freddie Mercury, of course, and the bands continued. So you guys are continuing. You're celebrating, 40 years?
I think it's even more.
Let's just say 40 years.
What's it like when a band loses someone who is the sort of the,
well, you know,
the face
it's
of the band?
Kind of like the end.
So you've lost a brother. He was your best mate. We'd been together 28 years.
And we did have promoters actually trying to get us back together again without Ted. No, I just was. Yeah.
We all said no.
The Ted Mulry Gang without Ted.
Okay.
You know?
Let's cut to the chase. You're going back on the road this year, and why did you decide to tour when you got a band called Ted Mulry Gang?
Because Zimmer frames are really expensive at the moment. We want to get those scooters, you know, with the pole and the flag.
I think the Rolling Stones have already clinched that deal.
That's right. As long as all your venues are wheelchair accessible, I think it should be all right.
Exactly. Right on, man.
What happened is Ted played bass. His brother Steve Mulry sings, who can't play bass. So last year, for some gigs, we had Mark Evans from ACDC on bass.
Fantastic.
Tony Mitchell from Sherbet. We're launching that this Saturday night at the Bridge Hotel in Roselle.
Do yourself a favour.
And we've got Tony Mitchell from Sherbet helping out.
Oh, my God, it's
bass,
a super group.
You should get the Hoff to come down and do a jump in my... Come on, Hoff, if you're watching. I know you're
a big...
Well,
why don't you come down and we'll introduce you as the Hoff?
I'm more the Hoff.
Can you play bass?
Yeah, I can play bass.
Oh, my God, this is turning into a dive. You guys, it's been absolutely fantastic to have you on. You are genuine rock and roll
legend. It's been a pleasure, mate.
Thank you very much.
Herb Kovac,
Doug and Gary Dixon. Gary, Herb Kovac, Gary Dixon.
Sit down.
Ted Mulry Gang. Oh, look, rock and roll is so polite these days.